Thank you, all of us. But before we close, I would just want to open the floor to the audience. So question and answers, and simple ground rules when you're asking a question to the panelists. Please, your name, your company, and what you do.
Yeah, I'm Pawan Saini from Praj Industries. And whenever I attend such HR forums, you know, the HR function comes out very glorified. But my personal view is still, although we talk that HR should talk the business language, and they have started talking, HR, I feel, is still far away from being seen as a business partner and being called to the boardroom when important business decisions are being taken. So I'm just wondering when HR will get that position, that they are really business partners.
Very good question. So can somebody please?
See, we already have that position. If you ask me, are we a profit center or a cost center? I tell my team, you guys are a performance center. Yeah. What I mean by a performance center is HR needs to have courage. And when I say courage, you need to have courage to uphold performance. The first way you can do to uphold performance is ensure that goals of everyone in the organization is such that it is actually a flow down of what the organization wants to achieve, X percent revenue and Y percent margin. Now, we already spoke a lot about, you know, we are shown a finger to say, cut cost, do this, do that, ta da da da. But I think more important than not, the change that I have seen in my own career is earlier, if an employee or a manager came to me saying, Kavita, isko promote karna hai, we have to, you know, send this person on site, or we have to have X percent increase given to this person or incentive given to this person, usually the team would act as a conduit between the person who is asking and finance. Questions would not be asked by us as HR. Now, today if you see anything that lands on an HR table is audited, is questioned, is torn to bits. We need to find out the reason why. Is it really important for this person to travel on site? Is it really important that he deserves X percent promotion, etc.? Now, how does that come? That comes because I understand business. That comes because I understand where the P&L account is today. So every request that comes from the ground is logically argued. And only then do we say, yes, you know, I can go and this is what I need to do. This is an approval that is genuine, so on and so forth. So this is just one part of your answer, but I think we are already there at the table, because without HR, you really can't get the company runs on margin. That is, I mean, all of us know it, but without HR, you really can't implement most of these decisions, and decisions also cannot be taken without HR in that group
to
there.
Answer your question simply, are we sitting on the board meetings? Are
we
sitting on the strategy meetings? And the answer is yes. It is happening in some companies, it may not be happening in some companies. But today, the answer is that if you understand business, you sit in the board meetings, you sit in the strategy meetings, and you have an equal opportunity to contribute. It's up to you to take, and I think it is there in many companies. I'm not talking about this.
And Dr. Sen, why did I say that this is the best time to be in HR? This is the frontier for differentiation today. If you look at surveys or you look at companies today and you look at the primary tasks of the leaders, what is the task of the leader? First and foremost, it's to define purpose and bring goal clarity. And associated with that is to build a positive culture. And we haven't talked explicitly about the crucial importance of culture in organizational productivity, longevity, performance, and who's most responsible within the organization for creating the many nuanced elements of culture. It's HR. So I would frankly rebut that notion that HR is not getting invited. If anything, they're being sought out. And if they're not, then those organizations are being myopic and will soon make that evolution. Power.
Just to also add, see, if you look at various organizations, Xerox, General Motors, you have those Dunkin' Donuts, you have Hindustan Petroleum, you have Aditya Birla, all these people who have actually were HR professionals who have gone ahead and become CEOs in those organizations. The most important question is, I was going through a couple of surveys. Approximately 70% of the HR professionals don't want to actually get into that position. Okay? What is necessary is, if you want to be there, you will be there. And it's no rocket science. If you look at business, marketing, sales, operations is fairly generic. Yeah, I understand that you need to have some technical expertise when it comes to IT, when it comes to finance, etc. But I don't think it's tough. The more you listen, the more you participate, the more you want to be in that particular chair, in that position of authority, I don't think it's difficult at all. And it's happening more and more now. HR is getting involved. It's getting, grilled to a huge extent, okay? Because the moment something is not happening, the first question that line manager says is recruitment not happening, or quality of people not good, or people have not been developed, or technically they have not been trained, or we don't have a leadership force in place. So these are the typical challenges in any service organization. So I think HR is already there.
So to be fair, I think you've asked a very straight, fair question. I appreciate that. This is a panelist of HR people sitting here. But specifically, I just want to know, is there any specific person you want to address this to, specific organization or maybe industry? So it's a broad observation which you wanted to ask. Okay. Yes?
Hi. So thank you so much for the panelists. Yeah. Really nice discussion. My question was primarily focused. Sorry.
Your name, and where you come from.
My name is Ashok. I'm from Kimberly Clark. My question was essentially primarily derived from this generation discussion which we had, and really long discussion which we had. Often when you read articles from Harvard, Wharton, and these, and there is a very critical perspective, is that essentially there has been an era of innovation in HR, where the processes of performance management, talent management, engagement were set up. But there was this era, and this is, and today as we look back and when we continue for moving towards in that aspect, there has not been a radical change as such. So if you were to see a simple process of succession planning, I don't think there is anything radically different which any other organization would be doing. My question to the panelists is that, why this lack of innovation within the function? It's a critic's view. I'm also part of the same fraternity. I just wanted your perspective.
Are you directing this at anybody, or
not to anyone specific? Yeah. Analyst can answer.
Can I take that?
Please go ahead.
Okay. So, have you seen any radical changes in sales or marketing, or in operations? Okay. Business is not about always making radical changes. It's more about doing the right things at the right time. You need not have great innovative ideas all the time. Okay, what's more necessary is to have a hard nose in terms of all the figures in place and to ensure that you are making profits. That's my view.
Simple.
I'd say that the innovation is happening in the interweaving of different functions. You know, today it's like you may have learned, as it were, the science, but the art is how you blend the different elements of, you know, whether it's performance management at one level or how to actually motivate and engage people for higher performance. At its heart, one is the measurement, one is the stimulus. Those who are implementing policies in a much more linear manner are not getting the exact results. So HR that is most innovative today, they are boundary spanners. That is one. The second is, I think there's a tremendous emergence of analytics that are genuinely useful, and analytics that have departed from just the traditional numerical focus into qualitative assessments that are still very vital and predictive in giving people performance. So those are some of the boundaries of innovation that are indeed occurring, and I believe HR is right at that forefront for that.
Your name and where you from?
Senior Director of MCCI, Maratha Chamber of Commerce. Basically, right now, everybody knows in all industries what type of situation is there. World over, and in India also, is slowdown, recession, whatever you call. The businesses, they are in trouble. That is in simple language. And what now the role of HR, or the so-called innovative solutions from HR to save the business, or then the improve the business, whatever. Giving the solutions to the top management for this type of situations, which otherwise marketing or finance or other departments may not be in a position to give. So the motivation of the people, how to keep it at the high level, including the moral of the people, and some other innovative solutions to come out of this situation to whatever extent. Sure.
So this is again more directed towards cost if you look at the environment that we are today.
Not necessarily. Cost is a common thing, but the innovation in many very different out-of-box solutions which can bring to the table, and then there can be a different who nobody, even the business owners can't and so can't innovate, but you can innovate. Something like that, is it there, something like that. Then I think there is some role for HR in this type of situations, and they are going to come frequently. So then you stand distinctly than other functions. If it is not there, say, second thing which Yogesh also touched, it is very important. The inspiration, making people inspired or making them passionate about the company's goal or the business goal, whatever. Keeping their moral high. This inspirational leadership, nobody has time to give that type of leadership because business people, they are busy in different things. So there may be, whether HR has any role to give this type of inspirational leadership ongoing, and is there any, what you call the structure manner they can give it, and ongoing they can give it, and not X person is there and he goes and it is no more there, something like that. Whether it can be institutionalized that there is some function of giving a leadership which otherwise it is absent many times.
Sure. So any interventions, any initiatives, any inspirational, any efforts which will basically motivate, galvanize and engage people in these difficult times. Am I correct in rephrasing that for you? Anybody would want to respond?
A couple of things, and I'm just quoting an example. It's not a solution to all problems, but to answer your specific question is that Dr. Sen, I think, said is which is very valid. HR can play a very important role today. Are we really getting into a discussion of explaining people what is the purpose? And that purpose is a big, big play. And it's a difficult one. And let me not try to simplify it. So that is one area which we are doing. Second area, to answer your question about institutionalizing, is can you really involve line managers in doing some of those things? And I'll give you a very simple example. We started an initiative called Jugnu. Jugnu is a Hindi word for firefly. Saying that, can we just harness some energy? One is that we also have our own cost-cutting measures and cost efficiency. That is hygiene. We said, okay, can we start something parallelly? So we started this moment. What we did is that we trained the operational managers on a simple process called appreciative inquiry. And instead of HR doing it, we are there as a facilitators, but managers conduct an appreciative inquiry on their own unit, asking them the standard process of appreciative inquiry, and not get into details. And finally leading to the dream of their own operations and for their own team. And they take the excellence projects. And you should see the energy coming up in that. And not only the people get energized, the managers themselves get energized. Because every time as managers, we are great at doing reviews and what is not working. A manager stands there and does an appreciative inquiry to his team. Managers have come and told me, my God, my team has so many positive things to say and they have this dream. I'm more excited. I mean, it does not take any cost. It does not take any cost. People are smart. They understand the environment and the environment is tough. So if you create an excitement through their managers, through the line managers, and to me, the most key is the middle management. Sometimes the senior management is excited about something. The people down also are enthusiastic to do something. But we do not cover the aspirations of the middle management. So what we have started working, I'll not get into the details, is we started with a very single focus agenda. All our initiatives are focused on, can we make the middle managers look ultimate heroes in front of their people? Whether it is conducting an appreciative inquiry, conducting those workshops, connecting with people, it creates an abundant energy in a system when the times are tough, you know, when you are giving single digit increments, where the industry was always giving double digit kind of increments. And it's fun. And talking about the innovation earlier, I mean, to me, these are the kind of things that are innovation. And the second innovation which comes to my mind is the social media which you touched upon. The organizations are becoming more and more distributed. I think our systems are way behind in terms of catering to the organizations which are distributed, contributory. Our systems are still a little monolithic on that. And I think if we have to at all cover an area, more and more people are going to say that, look, we are a group of five people, we'll provide this service to you. We don't want to be employed with you. Do we have the HR systems to, you know, monitor that kind of a performance, get that kind of people in your fold and address? Because the organizations are going to be distributed. Organizations are going to be of people who will say, I don't mind working my skill, but I don't want to be tied up with you. And our HR systems, I mean, the next wave of innovation as I see it would come into this area, that can HR really build up a scalable model for the organizations that are distributed, the organizations that are spread over in literal sense of term with a huge presence on social media, because our systems are still monolithic.
Second generation systems, absolutely. Third generation workforce. I hope we've been able to successfully answer.
Well, I mean, let me add to that. I think that was a great point about when you talk about an innovation, the management of telecommuting and distributed work in a productive manner. That has profound productivity implications. It also has cost implications. It has positives for engagement and satisfaction. So that's a genuine innovation that is moving the needle. Who's really managing that interface? It's HR. The other side, I think HR is having a profound impact, is in flattening organizations. Again, in enabling communication more frequently across levels, making it permeable. That's, again, a current generation phenomenon. And that, too, has large financial and performance implications. So I would single out those two as being very important innovations that are being really managed and spearheaded by HR.
To the question that you asked, sir. Fairness in today's world, as far as HR is concerned, is paramount. Because what we say is there is a recession. All of us are aware that good performance will lead to recognition, and recognition will lead to respect. Now, when we keep inspiring people by saying, you know, you need to perform well, and you need to be much better over the bar as compared to where you were earlier, I had to go back and relook at our salary and incentives model and ensure that the people who were the highest performers, the best performers, were paid and rewarded and recognized much better as compared to the ones below. So we looked at the gap between the best performer and the next best and the next best and the next best, and we made sure that there was a considerable difference, and we were able to sell it to employees saying, you do this and you get over the bar. So people know that it is fair. The manager does not really have a role to play saying, even if you are, you know, an okay person and there's someone else in the team who is a far greater performer, he doesn't really play a role in equating the salaries. There will be a difference and we will maintain that. So you can call it an initiative or you can call it ensuring that engagement of the employees on the ground, that the culture of this company is fair. If I have worked and burnt the midnight oil and ensured X outcome, I will be rewarded.
And adding to Kavita's point on fairness, fairness as demonstrated by the managers. Mm. So we have taken a little different approach. 2 years back, we first of all told people how increments work in this company. Second of all, I set a guidelines and said that these are the guidelines, and actually I distributed the money to the line managers.
Yeah.
And we told people that your salaries are determined by your line managers. They determine your performance, they determine your line managers. My job is to ensure that there's a fairness. So actually the conventional job of HR, where everybody can very happily blame HR that I'm not happy with the salary, blame HR, is gone. Actually, the roles have reversed completely. I audit them.
Correct.
For the fairness. So and I give them the budgets.
So the line manager here becomes the HR manager.
Absolutely.
That's what we look for to be the main responsibility of the line manager.
Because we say that, look, you understand your people well and you are impacted by them the most, then here is a guideline, here is a budget. No longer I take any pleasure in actually calculating person-to-person salary.
Okay.
But once you do that, I will audit it for fairness, to Kavita's point, so that we don't leave it to a laissez-faire kind of a thing. And it is appreciated because people know that their salaries are now determined by closer to their workplace.
So I think I'll have to pause here on that question now. Any other questions? Because
Yogesh,
in the benefit of time.
Can I ask, please?
My name is Manav Prasad. I'm from Composites. A related question to you, Yogesh. This next generation, right? The new guys are more explored or more exposed to the flat hierarchy kind of system. Okay, so they also come with something like, you know, they are vocal. And most of these guys actually, the smart guys get through companies like Kavita's or yours. So how's that? As in, the moment they ask this question to their line managers, like, what is there in it for me? I'm kind of sure that it's really not taken that great. So I would like to pinpoint this question to two of you. You know, how's that you guys take? And is that answered actually? I mean, considering the size of the companies that you have.
So let me understand your question. Is if a candidate asks HR?
An employee.
If an employee.
That's right.
If we ask honestly, what's in it for me in this organization?
No, not exactly in the organization. Let me rephrase that. So what happened with a friend of mine, you know, so he was placed on a staff assignment, okay?
Can you repeat that again?
Staff augmentation assignment. And you know, a staff augmentation assignment, usually the company gets better rates as compared to what you give to your employee. And this guy actually went back to his manager or the HR probably and went and asked, you know, what's there in it for me because I'm spending extra hours and other things. Probably that wasn't taken well because it was a big organization or something like that. So how's that? I mean, how do you react to such a question?
Two parts to the question. First of all, you asked about is the generation, young generation looking for a flatter organization? To which my answer is that I don't know. Because they are also aspiring to have promotions every second year. And if you aspire to have a promotion every second year, you can't have a flat organization. Point number one. And I don't know the answer. So I don't have an answer to that. The second is that there's no choice. People will ask difficult questions. I mean, as a company, you can either feel bad or you can, and that's where I come back to my points, because most of the times these traction points happen at a middle management level. If you do not involve them, empower them, and get them really on aligned, finally the answers what they give to other people, you will never have a control, because finally people are people. So that is one. Second is just a specific query on that person saying that, you know, you are getting a better rate from a customer, why don't you give me higher pay? This happens in our industry, and our answer is very simple. A is that we are still paying you even if a customer is not paying us for you. So do not try to become a commodity and sell yourself. And we actually say it in these words.
No, it's actually, if you look at it, you know, these rates sometimes differ from person to person. If the person is really, really good technically, the companies can charge a premium for that. I mean, I know certain cases around that. That's the reason I'm asking this. So how's that? I mean, how do you react to it? So is that guy gets an answer? Does that guy gets an answer to that or not?
It depends on the philosophy of your company. Mm. I mean, I say a very clear philosophy that we are not a body shopping company where if I get more money, I'll give you more money. If you get less money, I'll give you less money. That's the philosophy. Because both sides should work. And you set an expectation right to people saying that, look, you are on this customer project tomorrow. And there's another risk from an organization point to do that. Because if you start linking the pay to the rate that you are getting from a customer, for example, tomorrow you may be working on a strategic project which are internal. No good person would ever like to work on that if you have this philosophy of payment. And you just have to be absolutely clear about it.
So I agree.
Going back to what Kavita said, people just want to see the consistency. I mean, they may not like it, but as long as they see that you are fair and consistent in applying this philosophy across, they don't mind. When they see the hodgepodge approach that, you know, if you shout more, you might get something, and if you don't shout, you don't get, then you have a problem.
So can I say something? For the benefit of the audience also, there are two, three more questions. Can you take this offline with the...
Sure,
with
the with, transaction.
Yeah. There's a question right behind. Ma'am, please.
I think so.
Oh, sorry.
Well, I'd like to start by introducing myself. I'm Kajal Malik. I work for Guardian Developers, and I'm from marketing. So while you were addressing sales and marketing, so it's a question for you. Has HR ever looked at how employees can make profits while they work with them? Is that an innovation that HR thinks of? In the age and stage where remuneration beyond a point is not in your control, people are today looking for more tangibilized areas. So has HR ever looked at opportunities to make their employees make profit? I have an idea of what we are attempting to do, but I'd like to hear from you. Then I would share what we are attempting to do at our end.
Are you directing this question at somebody specifically?
No.
At the panel?
Really. No, not really. Anyone.
So at anybody in the panel? Okay. And anyone would want to sort of start off?
Middle class became richer by the ESOPs and all those in the 90s, and that is today no longer as attractive as it was because of the whatever tax regime and the other reasons. There are different ways and means of doing things, but honestly, nothing has come as sharp and clear as an ESOP which came out at that point of time. I mean, but that has lost all its charm.
Is your question profits for employees or profits for the organization?
Employees, for employees.
How do I create wealth?
I mean, today I think, you know, I'll give you a very simple example which we've attempted while we were listening on social media. A lot of employees internally were saying, what are the investment opportunities where I know my money is safe, I'm making some money while I'm also earning, right?
Okay.
So what we did was we actually created opportunity where we are into real estate. So we have a lot of projects coming up. So we started to share a lot of information and giving that opportunity to our own employees to begin with, right? And today I think we can proudly say that a lot of people are far happier because they've seen that increase while they continue to earn. So we realize while we're going to the outside world, why not offer that opportunity to our own employees? So I thought that was one area that we attempted to do. In fact, in today's forum, we've also tried to bring in that aspect to a lot of corporates who are present here. As a corporate, we are also looking for opportunities to tell you to share such opportunities with your groups, because those are safer options, and I think you have far happier employees looking at some wealth opportunities while they're working with you.
So we do that. In fact, apart from tax planning, what we also do is trying to explain to the individual that the moment you join an organization, please do not have immediate plans to get married, buy a house, buy a car, because that means you're going to have a loan on your head. So we do have a lot of these sessions, and we have external agencies who come in who explain the importance of wealth, the importance of wealth creation, as well as what are the different opportunities available. But then, of course, there is no tie-up, so to speak, because the decision of the employee is purely his. But more important for us, from a personal counseling perspective, you know, when you have employees coming in and speaking to our in-house counselor, we've had a lot of people getting depressed because they thought they could manage within this kitty, but they can't manage within this kitty, blah, blah, blah. So we start off by saying importance of wealth. This is how old you are. Your career is a marathon and it's not a sprint. And this is the amount that you will make in this year. So ensure that you plan ahead well. And then, of course, we add what you just mentioned.
Yeah, but I think so. He just wanted to respond.
Can I ask one last question, please?
Okay, please go ahead.
This question is addressed to either Kavita or Dobson, any one of them. Both of you referred something related to traditionalist and Gen Y and Gen X. Okay? My question is, do we really experience a difference between approaches based on someone is traditionalist or someone is from Generation X or Y? It really depends on what type of approach individual has towards the business. Maybe it's from any generation. Now, in any generation, you will find the best people as well as the bad people, maybe in traditionalist or in Generation X and Y. Does it depend on individual, or it depends on a approach of chief executive as to how organization should get nurtured by their people management? Because in generic way, there will be four pillars: strategy, technology, cost cutting, and sales and marketing. But then you see a person like Vinit Nair, he will say that people first. So what do you feel, Kavita or Dr. Sen? Any one of you, please. Thank you very much.
So my immediate response to that is, when I go to my boss, I take printouts and go. But when I call my team, they all have their laptops. So that's besides the point, but I think more important is ensuring that everyone in the organization at the leadership level is sensitive to the fact that you have four generations. The approach has to be different when you're speaking to a set of people who have just joined you from colleges, to when you're speaking to clients, to when you're speaking to different your colleagues from different functions. But when we say that there are four generations, you need to be sensitive. Earlier, it wasn't so. You say this is what you have to do and this is your policy and this is how you have to go about it, you go about it. But now, you need to buy in their views. Everyone in Gen Y has a point of view. Everyone, whether it's a Facebook or whether it's a LinkedIn, everyone will have a point of view, whether it is an area of expertise or not. So as long as you are sensitive to this entire workforce, as long as you appreciate it, I think it's only then that you will get the productivity that you require. If you just go back and tell them this is what you have to do, et cetera, maybe a certain section will go ahead and implement, but not the rest.
Okay.
So I think
I'll also have to cut short. Beyond this, we also short in time. So Dr. Sen, and I'll allow for just one last question.
I want to say something different, actually. I think you actually, the essence of your question was, the answer was in the way you phrased it. That yes, the leadership has to set the tone, but then the individual, as Kavita said, has to be empowered and sensitized to the communication. But I want to make a more general comment to all of you as HR professionals, is that we can get very, very stuck with so-called extrinsic incentives, you know, which is money. Do this, money. Do this, get more incentives. And there's plenty of evidence to show that that decays. There's a declining return to scale. The vibrant organizations focus on creating intrinsic motivation. As we know from our own behaviors, those things that we want to really want to do that drive us often don't have anything to do with the money at the end of it. And so the trap is to think that yes, paisa phenko, tamasha dekho, but it doesn't happen that way. In you can just map your own experiences. And so the question to ask yourself is, how am I breeding intrinsic motivation for excellence? How am I breeding intrinsic alignment with what the firm is trying to do? And I suspect sometimes we don't spend enough time with that. We take the shortcut of saying, okay, yeah, we've got to just give money, and that tends to decay very quickly.
Okay. So one last question, if there's any, because I think we're really running out of time. Okay. One last to the gentleman there, and we will close.
My name is Arun, and I'm from Tata Bluescape Steel. So I think we had a few pretty complicated questions. Let's end with a very simple question. But I'm pretty sure that the answer which I'm going to expect from each of the five panelists is going to be pretty unique and different.
So you're asking a question.
When we talk about HR, about people management, various things, various aspects come to our mind. So we think about getting the right people inside the organization. We think about learning and development, coaching, paying them well, and so on and so forth. My question is, if I ask the panelists as to what is that single one thing within the domain of HR which is the most significant priority, which should be the single one, the most priority, the single item of most, you know, highest priority for the HR professional, what is a single aspect within the domain of HR would be?
Credibility.
Pardon?
Credibility.
Okay.
I'll focus on engagement when it comes to the employee. Engagement.
Okay.
So you're asking each and every one of us?
Absolutely, yeah.
I mean, you, oh, okay.
Will you pick up number one best choice from there?
Anup?
I was talking to one person and then one HR professional, and then he said that probably in today's world, what is very important for HR people is to be able to link the efforts of HR with the direct outcomes through a series of matrices, simply put matrices, because that will make the work of HR more credible in the eyes of the business and people. So this is one thing which I came across while talking to one person. So that is the reason I wanted to ask each one of you.
For me, it's customer centricity. Whether you are in HR or in business, ultimately, customer is your king. So for an HR, it's maybe the employees, maybe the stakeholders, the shareholders. So I think customer centricity is extremely important. Whatever they demand, you have your mind to think as an HR, you feel it's feasible, it's worthwhile, deliver it.
And when we talk about customers, do we mean internal customers, that is functions, business
all.
People?
All. Okay. All your customers.
I would say really, and it's been covered, is the sense of equity and fairness. I think if there's one thing that people look for beyond it all is the sense of being treated on par. And if HR cannot convey that sense of fairness, then literally the organization's other efforts tend to dwindle.
Which is similar to, I think, somebody said, Yogesh, yeah. The credibility.
Kavita had said how that
to,
earlier.
Yeah, how to maintain
about the fairness, fairness more than credibility. Credibility. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, so thank you very much to all of us who are here in the audience and the panelists. Before we close, I just have one little question to ask the panelists is, what is that one thought, what is it that you have, what is that one worry that you have for 2014 from your side as an HR leader? Okay, within anything, within 10, 20 seconds, I just want you to have that one thought. What is it that keeps you awake going forward in 2014 about people, about processes, about current economic situations? What is it that you really think through and really keeps you occupied most of the time?
Actually, the happiness quotient of employees within the organization. That's what I'm really worried about.
Okay.
For me, it would be profitability.
Profitability. Profitability. Okay.
For me, it's really understanding and aligning talent. That's the, to me, is always a permanent complexity, and you know that has to be addressed. And that, how deeply are we listening and understanding the person to understand their true talent?
For me, it's maintaining the vibrancy of a people organization, because economic cycles will come up and come down. How do you really maintain a vibrant people organization? Which delivers and has enjoyment, because vibrancy has two aspects. One is that there's a life in that, and second is that there's a positive energy to deliver. So
interesting. So interesting different points of view from, you know, each and every one of us individually. So to close, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the time you spent, for the question and answers. I just want to really summarize quickly, and I think that from all the three themes that we picked on costs, on demographics, and also on social media, quickly, just to wrap up, I think as HR professionals, we need to know numbers, we need to know the levers of business to really have a seat on the table. When it comes to the demographics, I think it's very important, the onus is for us to understand and engage with the millennials. There's a huge opportunity for organizations to understand the new generation. And the last part, when it comes to social media, we need to understand the medium well. We need to take advantage. There's no excuses for an organization not to have a presence. And I think it's HR responsibility and not marketing responsibility. So with those words, thank you very much to the audience and all to the panelists. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I would request the panel to just be seated for a little while more while we kind of wind up this evening. My heartfelt thanks to the distinguished panel for an excellent discussion. I think your diverse experience, your in various industries, countries, regions came out spectacularly well, and all of us got a great sense of how HR is kind of evolving in the current day. I think we saw a lot of industry trends being quoted, a lot of diverse perspectives coming up, as well as real life examples, and we are really grateful to you for that. I would like to now invite Harsh Vardhan, Executive Vice President, Global Marketing of Ramco Systems, to deliver the closing note. Harsh, please.
Good evening. I'll not take too long. I guess I'm the one holding up people from dinner there. Very quickly, just might be in two or three slides, I thought I'll just summarize a different perspective or exactly the same perspective this whole panel had. As an introduction, like I head the global marketing for Ramco Systems. One of the logos at the right at the top, we claim all the complex issues which got discussed. We have a solution for all of that. Come and see Ramco HCM on cloud. That's about the sales pitch from my side. But very quickly, I guess Kelvin started off by talking about, and the whole discussion was about new normal, VUCA, the speed at which things change today in the industry, the speed at which HR is expected to react to the changing markets, changing dynamics. And in such a situation, when you're looking at what we're talking about, volatile situation, and when you're talking about the economy is down, you want to right size. When economy is going up or when you're expanding, you want to continuously hire. Or when it's really going up, then you have your usual challenges related to talent management and employee attrition and higher salaries and so on and so forth. In such a scenario, when you're talking about, at the end of the day, it's all about data and the analytics which help you in taking these decisions. If you're taking these particular decisions, you have to have the data right with you when you want it, so that, and you're able to justify to your managers or to your bosses to ensure the right data points are given to ensure the right decisions are taken. In such situations, we're talking about solutions which can very clearly enable such decisions. Quickly, next. So we're talking about various profiles, next. We're talking about, next, very, I'm sure all of us have heard of one type of manager, or the personal manager who is still belongs to the old age, wants to remain in just about calculating office timings, doing some leave management and some administrative issues. Then you have an HR manager who's slightly evolved, would like to do operations, would like to do appraisals, and so on and so forth. And the final one, which was discussed fair bit of in detail, being a chief talent officer. And if you want to be a chief talent officer, you want to measure your human capital, the amount of all complex issues related to how you take your decisions on strategic issues for the organization. So when you're looking at such solutions, I would basically say, have a look at solutions. There are enough solutions available in the market now to give you a different perspective and go forward in terms of with very, very low costs. Today, you don't have to spend millions, or you don't have to spend months together to implement solutions. Couple of months, you are up, alive, and running without any investments in infrastructure or capital expenses. That's a very quick snapshot. And the last one, obviously, this also got covered quite a bit in terms of the millennial workforce, who want everything instant gratification, who want it now, who want it to be mobile, who want to take decisions, who are also very effective managers. So the last slide, we've summarized it as, when you're looking at millennials, you need something called, our way of putting it across is music. When you're talking about music, we talk about being mobile, having very clean, cool interfaces. Everybody wants solutions which have Facebook-like interface, so that even the oldies and the youngies, everybody wants to use the solutions very easily without any too much of training. Then you want it to be social, you want it to be, you want it now, you want the decisions to be taken right away, you want everything at full speed, there's no time to wait, you can't wait for old processors and so on and so forth. And the last, but not the least, is in terms of how context-aware the solutions are. You don't want to give answers to an ERP, you don't want the ERP system or a HR system to have too much of details to be punched in. You expect, if you're a salesperson traveling from one location to another all the time, you have a mobile phone in your pocket, it automatically knows which location you are, which locations you're going. You're going to a particular project, you're attendance entry, if you have a mobile phone, it automatically takes that coordinates and says, time and attendance entry is done. So in short, I would say that the life is all about music, which is what the HR or the Gen Y employees look forward to. This is a very quick snapshot of what we do as a business. Look forward to interacting with all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harsh, for a very crisp update on your work that you do and the discussion we had. I would now request Samir Bhosle, Head Western Region for Shine.com, to come up and felicitate the panelists. Samir, please. Thank you, Samir. Ladies and gentlemen, just a couple of minutes more as we come to the close of the 13th Hindustan Times Shine HR Conclave, the Pune chapter. It is my pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks to all who have made this possible. On behalf of Shine.com, we would like to express our heartfelt thanks to everyone present here. We would like to thank all the speakers for their sharing their considered views on the today's topic. Shine.com would like to continue to support the HR fraternity through such forums and through our products. We would like to meet you soon to explore opportunities and showcase how we can help you with your recruitment needs. We also thank our associate sponsor, Wide Wings, for supporting this event, our technology partner, Ramco Systems Limited, investment partners, Guardian Developers, knowledge partner, Symbasis International University, management education partners, Chetna's RK Institute of Management and Research, and our event partners, Crystal Honda, Blue Ridge Golf Club, Swipe Telecom, Technocorp, Ecoman NVO Solutions Private Limited, Rising City Rare Infrastructure Private Limited, TIT Institute, DSP BlackRock, Skywalls Balloon Safari, and Paranjpe. That is all for the evening. I would now request all of you to kindly join us for cocktails and dinner. Thank you.